Let's get over to him.
You dog.
Talk about
I like the Weather Channel.
You like
Chairman, President, and CEO, it's great to see you.
Good to see you.
It's been way too long since we've talked to you. We talk about all the risks that are out there all the time for the market, and yet we keep setting new highs. What do you think about what you see?
You know, look, times are good. We are setting new highs in the market. I think the Fed has gotten it right. They overshot last year, and I think they've pivoted back to the right level. You've got unemployment. I mean, the employment levels are fantastic. Inflation is muted. Economic growth is good. You know, what's all the fretting about? We need to get a trade deal done. That's okay.
That's what all the fretting's about.
That's
right. Happened again yesterday when there were these headlines crossing that suggested that we've hit another snag, that the Chinese don't want to put a number on the amount of agricultural purchases that they'll make, that they don't necessarily want to say that they will stop the forced transfer of technology. What does that tell you? Is it nervous, or are we getting closer to a deal?
You know, I think it's all negotiation. If you saw overnight, you saw the Chinese economy slowed with the numbers, industrial production in
more
China
than expected,
slowed more than expected.
But Germany did 0.1% growth.
Yeah, there you go. But in China, I think that the takeaway is that the tariffs are impacting the Chinese economy more than the U.S. economy. This is all a negotiation, although it is important, I think, to get a deal done, you know, before the end of the year.
Even if it's a skinny deal, even if it doesn't have some of the things that the business community has been hoping for?
Well, look, they're saying it's phase one, and this is going to be an ongoing process. So I think the biggest risk to the markets today is probably trade. But let's not lose sight of the fact that we're in some pretty good times. And as we look forward, we don't see a recession. We've changed. I was on a couple of weeks ago. We've changed from defensive to cyclical. And we think you should be investing in financials and energy, as what you're saying, and industrials. So we think the market has a good tone here.
You think energy because you think the economy is picking up and therefore more energy will be used around the globe? Or like Jim Cramer was saying yesterday, look, you can buy energy even as kind of a hedge against an Elizabeth Warren presidency because, you know, you will see eventually energy prices pick up and if there are curbs on the drilling.
I think it's just more saying they're economically sensitive and so energy, we think energy is going to be $75 and, you know, is our thought on energy in terms
of. Ron, are you plus, are there going to be tariffs December 15th or no tariffs?
You know, if I knew the answer to that, I could make a market bet here. I believe they'll probably push that off myself. I think that's a cliff.
No new tariffs, you mean?
Right, that's what I mean.
New tariffs would be.
Now what the Chinese seem to be looking for is to get rid of some of the existing tariffs that are.
I'm doing, Becky, an informal CNBC guest survey with every guest that I'm on with, and most of the market is betting on no new tariffs.
I would assume
that's the bet that's out there in the market. I think that's part of the reason why we can be at all-time highs because we're sort of discounting this threat.
If there were no trade war, would we be 10% higher?
I think the market would be higher. I don't know that
you
I'd put a number on it, but yes, I do. I think that is.
We already think it's so over. You know, everybody that comes on thinks it's so overvalued.
I wouldn't say that.
You wouldn't.
I would not say that. I would say that there's risk to the market, but I believe that if you get a trade deal and
there's still more
in the
left
market, there. Well, again, I wouldn't be saying.
We just said the Atlanta Fed's at 1%.
Yeah, and New York Fed at 0.8. Our CNBC rapid update's a little bit hotter at 1.6. And that's the median of all of the forecasts on the street right now. So
will that be the low, do you think, if Europe's recovering and if China comes back?
That's another thing, Joe. I think the market trades right now with this notion that somewhere between the fourth quarter and the first quarter is the trough in the slowdown. Uh-huh. And there's two components of that. The first is that the slowdown doesn't get much worse than 1 to 1.5%. It has a whole number in front of it. It doesn't go negative. And then it's over by, say, the second quarter of 2020. I think that's the horizon of the market.
Right. But in the summer, we forget what the risks were in the summer. In the summer, we were talking about the Fed. That risk, I think, has been taken off the table. Brexit. That was a risk. Everyone was going, oh, my, oh, my. I think Brexit is not going to have the impact on the market. And the third was trade, and that one's still out there.
Were we too tight so that a recession was possible, but was it all just a phantom menace? Do you know?
You know,
I mean, we were really pretty sure.
I don't think anyone...
Was it all just in our imagination, Leisman, or did we have to deal with it?
Which part?
The recession right in front of, you know.
I would go back and tell you what I said the entire time, I thought a slowdown was baked in, and I thought the slowdown was made somewhat worse by the trade war.
Remember our breathless Dalio headlines about recessions?
I think that was overstated, and I was pretty consistent about
it. So it wasn't that the Fed averted a recession by cutting. It was that it was never going to happen in the first place.
I keep thinking about this. I think what the Fed said is we're going to get to Albuquerque by Tuesday, right? And they kept that forecast that we're going to get to Albuquerque by Tuesday. That's the 2% growth forecast. They had to push the accelerator more to get there because of the idea of the trade.
I think the Fed raised 4 times. I think they overshot the neutral rate. Even today, people think the neutral rate's 2.4. I don't think it's there. I think we're kind of there now.
But where is it?
You know, I think right where we are now. If economically, maybe 2. Okay, but I don't think it's 2.5. I think there's a new environment. It's for the next number of years, we're going to be talking about.
We did
about
4 and said we're a long way from. We did 4 and the guy in charge said we're a long way from neutral. That doesn't help, probably.
Well, that's true. But look, let's give the Fed credit here.
Yep.
The Fed pivoted when they needed to pivot. They cut 3 times. They averted what I think could have been a recession.
So they did avert it. Okay, then it wasn't a phantom.
I think so.
I was more optimistic about the Trump economy and the possibility of tax cuts that I think the president undermined with this trade war.
Okay.
I thought you could do 2.3 to 2.5, and right. I was thinking about a higher neutral rate because I thought there was greater possibilities.
Then you have to acknowledge the possibility that long-term there could be a method to the madness in dealing with China, and it might be something that this is when we should do it, maybe not with tariffs, but it could, down the road, the IP stuff, the state-owned stuff, helping them come into...
Although, I got to say, if you're watching what they're pushing for now, it's back to the old status quo.
I know.
So that's the key, Becky. Yeah. But the president has now acknowledged that the ways that other administrations dealt with the China problem the right way, which was to compartmentalize issues, not go for the whole enchilada at once.
They didn't compartmentalize anything except...
That's what phase one is, Joe.
I know. No, but other administrations, all they did, the only compartment was appeasement.
I just wonder if this is going to be any more effective.
That's not true.
They're
doing it the way others
have
done it.
Through the WTO. Well, we didn't have a whole lot of success for the last
15.
We had
plenty of success. Why did we end up at this point?
Because the
president decided to make a huge populist political issue out of trade.
Well, suddenly a lot of the populace is in favor of it because the whole attitude is...
A lot of populace knows about trade from the president's Twitter account.
Ron, great to see you.
I love the fact I got on here and didn't have to have one.
You didn't have to say a word.
Well, not in anything about
what do you think about it?
Are you not a billionaire?
I'm not a billionaire, so I'm out of the ads. If I was in one of those ads, it would be a good thing.
You got some clients.
You didn't know
I do have some clients.
So you like Elizabeth or you like Lee?
Yeah, look, I mean, that's not fair. I think that's not a fair question. I don't know either one of them that well, so I'm sure they're both nice people.
Was he running for office?
I might be.
Ron, you spoke too soon.
Yeah. I should
have almost got out of here.
I thought I got out of here.
He came from nothing and he's given all of his money away. How can you not?
I will say this. It is not surprising to me that on one hand, you've got a Medicare for All program that requires taxes across to everyone to finance that thing, and if you're gonna shy away from that, then you go after the billionaire class, and then the billionaire class is responding in a way that gets her on this show. I mean, this is free advertising, so it's an interesting thing that I see going on.
Ron, thank you.
You got it. Thank you.